Well, we are in the middle of an argument that Paul is making, an important argument, especially for those of us, as I assume most of you are, who are Gentiles. Paul writing to a group of Gentile believers in the churches of Galatia, having to do with salvation through faith alone. Now, I recognize that when we open up our Bibles to the New Testament, for most of us, it is enough to just say, hey, it's in the Bible, it's the Word of God, that's all I need to know. And with the Apostle Paul, I appreciate how God's Word doesn't just say, hey, I'm a prophet of God, just listen to what I have to say. But rather, what we read, especially in Galatians, is we see a logical, consistent argument being put forth, explaining how the Old Testament impacts the New Testament, explaining why God wrote what He wrote back when He wrote it, and why things are changed now. And so it appeals to our minds as well as to our hearts. And I love that about this section here. Again, those who would criticize our faith and would mock us and don't have the slightest clue what they're talking about. And yet we read clearly here how the old impacts the new. And so we begin with verse 15, where we left off last week, with the promise of the inheritance. Verse 15, chapter 3. Brethren, I speak in the manner of men. Though it is only a man's covenant, yet if it is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is Christ. And this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God, that it should make the promise of no effect. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise. So he's pointing out, from a time perspective, the priority of the promise given to Abraham centuries before the law ever showed up. And we are continuing what we began and looked at last week in looking at Abraham's life, both from verse 14 and the verses before, and how Abraham was declared righteous by God. He was justified by God through faith. And so when you get into verse 15 and the verses that we're going to be looking at, we are seeing a theme of inheritance. And so the covenant spoken of is like a will. And we know that once a will is confirmed, once it's put in force, and whether he was speaking from the Greek version or the Roman version, that's up to debate, and they had some differences, and I don't think it's significant to our point here. The point is, once it's in force, that's it. You can't add to it after the fact, and you can't take anything away. And Paul says, now I speak as a man. That's how we do it on the human level with our human contracts here. So how much more God, verse 17, when God says something, how are we going to add or take away what God has said by something that shows up hundreds of years later, namely the law? Now verse 16, let's dig into this a little bit. What's he talking about? The word seed in the sense of offspring shows up several times in the book of Genesis. It's one of those words that can have both a singular and a plural meaning, kind of like our word sheep. You can talk about one sheep or multiple sheep. The same thing goes here. Now, Paul knows that about the word. He understands how the word is used. And that's why, very significantly, he speaks of promises, plural, in verse 16. Because Abraham did receive more than one promise, didn't he? But later he's going to talk about promise singular, the one he's going to focus on. But to Abraham and his seed, singular, were the promises made. Now, one of those promises had to do with the land, didn't it? Genesis 12, Genesis 13, we see God promising to Abraham's seed the land forever. There the understanding is descendants, isn't it? To your descendants, you're going to get this land. And our New King James translation does an excellent job, translates those passages as descendants, properly. But Paul also references here another Genesis passage, this one found in chapter 22, verse 18, after Abraham has been declared righteous by God. Chapter 22, verse 18, we read, "In your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed my voice." This is the one that Paul's focusing on. In your seed, singular, not in your descendants, plural, but in your seed, singular, namely Jesus Christ, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Let's stop for a moment. If it was the descendants, plural, how could that come to be? You might have some fanciful interpretations. The Jewish people have been great contributors to society, a lot of inventors, Albert Einstein, you know. And no, that's not what it's talking about. It's not talking about the Jewish people blessing the entire world because there's some pretty good scientists and businessmen and all that sort of thing. It's talking about the singular Jesus Christ, who would be a blessing for all the nations of the earth. And quite significant, if you ask me, is when this was given. Again, I said Genesis 22, didn't I? I also said, because you have obeyed my voice, God added when he promised this blessing. What was going on in Genesis 22? Genesis 22 is when Abraham woke up one day and God said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. First mention of the word love in the Bible of a father and his only son. And go take him as sacrifice him as an offering, the place I'm going to show you. At that moment, Abraham was completely obedient and faithful to God. And so, in a sense, at that moment, Isaac was dead to Abraham, wasn't he? I mean, it hadn't actually happened yet, but it's going to happen. God had ordered it. But the Bible says that it took 3 days before Abraham got to the place where God said, okay, here it is. Now here's where you're going to do it. So how long was Isaac dead in Abraham's mind? 3 days. Interesting. It's also interesting that God would call Isaac Abraham's only son, because Abraham had another son, didn't he? Ishmael. Ishmael was his first son, but he wasn't the son of the promise. He wasn't the son through Sarah. He was the son when Sarah and Abraham tried to help God out a little bit. God promised them a son. Sarah says, I can't give birth, so go into my Egyptian handmaiden and let her get pregnant, and we'll call that our kid. And that's how Ishmael came into being, and God didn't even acknowledge Ishmael. He says, take your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and offer him there. And then we read in the book of Hebrews that in a figure, Abraham received his son back from the dead when God stopped him right when he was about to plunge the knife in, and he said, hold on, Abraham, I see you fear God, don't do it. Abraham recognized a problem, because Isaac was the promised son. He was going to be the one who was going to have future children, and yet Isaac wasn't even married yet. He didn't have any kids yet. So how in the world is he going to continue the line? And Abraham basically recognized, well, that's up to God. I guess God will have to bring him back from the dead. And so you see an incredible symbolic picture of when our Heavenly Father offered his only begotten Son out of love for all of us on the cross, where he was dead for 3 days, and then rose from the grave.